Funding for this program was provided through a grant from the Ohio Humanities Council, a state-based program of the National Endowment for the Humanities.
In the winter of 1920, the small Minnesota town of Sauk Center suddenly found itself the focal point of national attention. It was the publication of a novel, Main Street, by Sinclair Lewis, that turned the nation's eyes toward this central Minnesota community. The local people basked happily in the limelight for a short time, but their feelings soon turned to anger when the contents of the novel were fully known. Main Street was a biting satire that caricatured the townspeople and their institutions, and the public fury was directed toward the local man who had written the book. Sinclair Lewis's book shattered the romantic illusions of small town life that were prevalent in American literature at that time. And he joined a growing list of contemporary authors, Edgar Lee Masters, Sherwood Anderson, and Hamlin Garland, who debunked the myth of small town and village life. In the nearly seven decades since the publication of the book, Main Street has become a generic term for small town ways, personalities, and institutions. Main Street, too, resembles all other main streets in all other small Midwestern towns, from the eastern borders of Ohio to the western edge of Iowa. These towns differ little in physical appearance. Small shops and businesses line both sides of the street. There are the ever-present drugstore and bank and hardware and barbershop. Oh, and there's what we used to call the five and dime. Many towns, such as Sauk Center, used to have hotels, which date back to an era when salesmen, or drummers as they were called then, traveled by rail. Life in the town ebbs and flows along the street according to the ancient rhythms of sleeping, working, and playing. Life seems to move smoothly and evenly here, and we have a tendency to build romantic visions of small town living. We seem to feel that life there is somehow less complicated, simpler, more complete. But good sense tells us that this is mere idealism on our part. Sinclair Lewis, as boy and man, walked these streets many years ago and recognized that Sauk Center was typical. But he also saw something else. He looked beneath the surface of everyday living and saw that Main Street was representative or symbolic of American middle-class values and mores. And what he said about these values and ethics upset a great many people. Yet what he saw and reported and wrote about called to our attention our own shortcomings, and perhaps in some small way helped shape America. Though he used the small town as a setting for his scathing satires, it should be noted that Lewis was pricking our national conscience, and he reminded us that self-centeredness, bigotry, and hypocrisy are not the sole property of the small town or of the middle class. Lewis, of course, established Sauk Center as the symbol of the small town. Today, Sinclair Lewis is held in high esteem here, and he is without a doubt the town's most famous citizen. Ironically, he became the epitome of some of those values he so harshly criticized. He was, after all, the local boy who achieved the American dream of success, prominence, and wealth. He became an international figure. In many ways, he was the perfect example of the Horatio Alger hero. He grew up in an era when the Alger myth that honest hard work led to fame and fortune was believed by most people. Harry Sinclair Lewis was born on a cold, bone-chilling day in early February 1885 in a small house just up the block from here. He was only 7 when his mother died, and we don't know much about her. But his father, Dr. Edwin Lewis, was a respected member of the community who was known for his precise daily routine. People, it is said, could set their watches by the time Dr. Lewis left his office on Main Street to walk home for lunch. Dr. Lewis married again, and the family moved across the street to this house, the home where young Harry Sinclair was to spend his childhood and youth. Young Lewis grew up to see the end of the pioneering Western movement in America. The town was barely 3 decades old when he was born, and he was witness to its transformation from crude frontier village to an established agricultural community. The area was settled by New Englanders who staked out the town's site in the late 1850s. An Indian uprising in 1862 threatened the town, and the army quickly built a stockade around the general store. Once the uprising was quelled, things settled down to normal. Soon, immigrant Germans and Scandinavians began to move in, to break the hard prairie sod, to turn it into a golden ocean of waving grain. A grist mill was built, the railroad stretched to Sauk Center, and the town became an agricultural hub. Agriculture is still the economic mainstay of the area. Lewis, the youngest of 3 boys, grew up here where you could walk anywhere in town in a few minutes, or you could hike down the railroad track to the stone arch and take a dip in the old swimming hole, a place where once young Lewis would have drowned if it hadn't have been for his older brother, Claude. On the surface, at least, one would think that young Lewis led an ideal childhood, but that was just not so. This plaque, erected by the Minnesota Historical Society at the Lewis home, succinctly depicts those early years. A gawky, sensitive child who achieved little success in school and was the brunt of every crude piece of horseplay, Red Lewis spent most of his youth tagging after his adored older brother and doctor father and reading every book he could find. He was a voracious reader and consumed nearly all the classics in Sauk Center's Bryant Library. He devoured the works of Dickens, Scott, Kipling, and Kingsley, and was enraptured with the George Henty tales of adventure and heroism. He began to keep a diary at an early age and to write bits of poetry. Yet he did not excel in school and was graduated 17th in a class of 19. Certainly not an outstanding achievement for America's future first Nobel Prize winner. He turned to buffoonery in adolescence, became a cut-up in school, and as a result, was something of a discipline problem. He was growing to manhood in a lanky and ungainly way, and as with many youngsters, had poor coordination. In his awkwardness, he once inadvertently started a fire in the chemistry lab. He also tried his father's patience to the limit by repeatedly staying out too late. This so angered Dr. Lewis that on one occasion, he knocked his son to the floor and began to pummel him severely until his stepmother stopped the fracas. Lewis was 16 at the time and contemplated leaving home. "I will disappear tomorrow," his diary reveals, "make my way to Europe and travel a few years." But the next day he changed his mind and decided to spend a bit more time in Sauk Center. Much later in life, Lewis could answer the charge that he had missed the fun of childhood in a small town by saying that he had indeed found life exciting, colorful, and full of adventure. The heart of the matter is that Sinclair Lewis's childhood was a drab and painful period. He was never quite accepted by the other youth of the community, and as the plaque noted, was the butt of many cruel practical jokes. It is said that all through boyhood and youth, he had only one true friend, Irving Fisher. Even his father, the severe and puritanical doctor, never thought the boy would amount to much and made these feelings apparent. Yet Lewis adored his father all his life. Lewis learned early on that life can be lonely even in a small community such as Sauk Center. Young Sinclair Lewis, too, was aware of the culture that was developing in the town, a culture with its seemingly sophisticated clique of clubs and organizations fostered and supported by the progeny of the original New England settlers. This town culture contrasted sharply with the rougher, alien, rural way of life of the immigrant farmers. As a result, the old universal prejudices began to take root between the town on one hand and the farmers on the other. The town folk felt that they were somehow more urbane, more sophisticated, and more intelligent than the crude, ignorant farmers who strode Main Street on Saturday in their muddy boots. Perhaps because he was sensitive and alienated, young Lewis was able to see this phenomenon develop. He saw, too, that the town never missed an opportunity to exploit these country louts who talked with strange accents and whose clothing exuded unpleasant country odors. As he grew older, Lewis realized, of course, that Sauk Center was neither better nor worse than any other American town, and that the attitudes and philosophies of the people were representative of many Americans. Prejudice, he learned, like weeds, will grow in any soil. By the time he was ready to go off to college, Sinclair Lewis was well on his way to becoming a social critic, and the time for social criticism was ripe for him and others. America had emerged from a rural economy into the whirl and noise of the machine age, and America's values were shifting to materialism and the acquisition of material things that would mark a man as a success to his friends and enemies alike. Once the harsh realities of the frontier were conquered, men began to feel that a life of ease was their just reward, and it didn't matter too much how this wealth was accumulated. People were prone to shut their eyes to the methods employed to achieve success, and if these methods were perhaps slightly shady or unethical, well, that was just sharp business practice. And the pushers and hustlers with zip and go were the ones to imitate. It was the era of the robber barons. And young Sinclair Lewis began to wonder about the price that must ultimately be paid for success. Certainly he would have known how the seven Merritt brothers lost their vast holdings in rich iron ore leases in northern Minnesota through the sharp business practices of John D. Rockefeller and the Lower Lake speculators. Lewis was beginning to realize that there were two standards of ethical and moral behavior. One was practiced on Sunday mornings at church, and the other applied to the other 6 days of the week. He was privy to a host of stories about how the traveling salesman pulled off clever deals on the local businessmen. In Sauk Center for a short time in 1902, Lewis worked as an assistant night desk clerk at the then new Palmer House Hotel. And he listened in on the stories told over cigars and whiskey about how some boob had been taken by some sharp sales ploy. Lewis, who worked from 6 in the evening till 6 in the morning, was accustomed to seeing these nervous, tense men who exuded confidence, but whose voices betrayed their fear by being just a bit too loud and too strained and too high-pitched, and whose laughter was a tad too brittle. Later on, these faceless drummers of goods would find themselves in the pages of his novels. Lewis's commercial career at the Palmer House was short-lived, however, for he was fired for daydreaming. But his time had not been ill spent. He noted things, cataloged them, and tucked them away in his mind to use later with devastating effect. His caustic comments and satires would sting the conscience of the nation and make him one of America's most controversial authors. Lewis was graduated from high school about the time he was employed at the Palmer House, and he was determined to attend Yale University. He took the entrance examinations and passed 11 of the 13 tests. Not a bad showing for a boy who had been graduated so low in his class. It was decided that he would attend a preparatory school before reapplying to Yale, and Oberlin Academy was selected. But at Oberlin, he ran up against his old problem. He was not fully accepted by the other students. Although he was not shunned, he always seemed to be on the fringe of the crowd, and he would have gone unnoticed except for his lanky frame and carrot-topped head. Again, he formed no close friendships or acquaintances. His diary reveals a burning desire to get to Yale, where he thought he would be in the thick of things. But at Yale, too, he found that he would remain on the perimeter, and he would form only a few close relationships. He became a diligent student, spent most of his waking hours poring over his textbooks. One of his ambitions at Yale was to be an editor of the literary magazine. And since future editors were chosen by the number of their contributions that the magazine published, Lewis kept a steady stream of essays and articles flowing into the editorial offices. Most were rejected, but eventually he was picked as an editor, and from then on contributed a regular column. Lewis spent early vacations here in Sauk Center, where he fought desperately to stave off boredom. He found that somewhere along the way, he had shed the rural provincialism of the Minnesota small town. He also found that his friend Irving Fisher had left the area. It was during the first vacation that he began to think about a novel he would model around the town and its people. Originally, he called it The Village Virus. It would become Main Street 15 years later. Other vacation time was spent in Europe. In the decades before World War I, it was quite customary for the wealthy to send their sons and daughters on the grand tour of Europe before they settled down to careers and marriage and the other baggage of life. There was also the hope the young person might be able to snag a proper mate from among the European nobility. Sinclair Lewis's grand tour, though, was by way of a cattle boat on which he worked his passage across the Atlantic. And his education was augmented by the rough and tumble life of a seaman. Before his senior year, he became involved in the reform movement that burned across the nation. And he left Yale to join Upton Sinclair's socialist experiment in group living at Helicon Hall. Lewis and a friend hired on as janitors. It lasted a month, for as his diary reveals, I expected to work only 7 hours a day, which is to give me an income of $35 a month, with expenses for board and room of about $24. But until things get settled, I'll probably have to work nearer 17. He did not return to Yale and decided to head for California via the Panama Canal. The canal was still under construction, and Lewis figured he could easily find work and perhaps even adventure. He found no work and little adventure, and after selling the California portion of his ticket, returned to New York. What he did gain from the Panama misadventure was a journal packed with notes about his traveling companions, a mixed group of Irish, English, Canadian, Norwegian, and French working men. Once back in New York, he began to write for a living, and was successful in selling some of his poetry to such magazines as Life and Puck and Century. Kids' poetry and squibs, he later called this earlier work. During the era previous to the stunning success of Main Street, Lewis published 4 novels and many short stories. But the years before 1920 were what critic Mark Shore labeled a miscellany of false starts, lost jobs, lost hopes, loose ends, and erratic wanderings. It was a time of formation. And in this period of universal search for self and direction, he feverishly wrote short stories, poetry, articles, essays. He even sold story plot lines to Jack London. His first novel was Our Mr. Wren, published in 1914. And it would be followed by 4 other novels written during the next 6 years. The early work received little critical attention, and what attention it did get was mixed. It was his 5th novel, Main Street, that caused a firestorm of reaction, and Lewis suddenly found himself in the spotlight of notoriety. It was 1920, and America had emerged from World War I as a major power, a world leader. The war had changed the way Americans thought, and those who had stayed home were dismayed and puzzled by the views of the returning soldiers who now loudly disavowed many of the beliefs of the older generation. The romantic myth of the small town was being questioned, just as the towns themselves were fading in importance as America moved toward urbanization and young people began to flock to the cities that appeared to offer greater opportunities. Lewis was not the first American writer to look at the small town and see something other than handsome young lads and pretty apple-cheeked maidens who never seemed to experience the shocks and jolts of life. But it was Lewis's Main Street that outraged the reading public. The novel openly challenged many of the traditions and institutions to which Americans had faithfully and unconsciously subscribed. Lewis laid bare hypocrisy, bias, pettiness, and an exaggerated sense of self-importance. Quite naturally, the folks here in Sauk Center began to search the novel for prototypes of themselves, and being human, they found them. Although Lewis swore that his characters were not based on any living soul, but that they were merely composites of many people. The story is that the only place he was welcome in town after the book was introduced was the local garage located down on Main Street. However, in 1920, shortly after the book was published, a reception in his honor was held at the Palmer House Hotel here. Such is the stuff of myths. In later years, the anger has dissipated and vanished. The town has turned itself into something of a literary shrine, becoming a mecca for literary-minded tourists. Were he living now, Lewis would probably be amused, and he might even feel the urge to write a satire about it. What was it, then, that so angered people about Main Street? The heroine of the novel is a young woman, a recent college graduate, something of a rarity in the first decade of this century, who marries a doctor from a small town in Minnesota with the improbable name of Gopher Prairie. Carol Kennicott is a romantic idealist who wants to change the world, but since her world is to consist of Gopher Prairie, she sets out with zeal and enthusiasm to bring about a renaissance to this dusty little town. The remainder of the plot is predictable. She fails in every one of her reformation attempts. Although her husband has described Gopher Prairie as a darn pretty town with lots of fine maples and box elders and two of the dandiest lakes you ever saw, Carol's fears begin to mount as the train rolls north from St. Paul and passes through, quote, towns as planless as a scattering of pasteboard boxes on an attic floor, unquote. And she is nearly thoroughly disillusioned as the train slows and crawls to a stop at Gopher Prairie. The town in Carol's eyes is as dusty and as dreary and as dismal as all the other towns they had passed through. A short time later, she goes exploring, and she discovers that within half an hour, she had completely covered the town, east and west, north and south. And she stood at the corner of Main Street and Washington Avenue and despaired. But Lewis's heroine is plucky, and she vows to bring about the change she knows is abroad in the land. And almost immediately, she runs into the iron-hard conformity of the community and the shallowness of its institutions. Lewis devotes a good share of the novel to satirizing Carol. He establishes her character early on as being a trifle flighty, and it is difficult to take seriously someone who meditates on walnut fudge, the plays of Brieux, the reasons why heels run over. Carol, too, has a tendency to leap from one cause to another. As a student at Blodgett College, she hoped to discover that she had the ability to act, to write, to manage organizations. Always, she was disappointed. But always she effervesced anew over student volunteers who intended to become missionaries, over painting scenery for the dramatic club, over soliciting advertisements for the college magazine. Her ambition was to conquer the world, almost entirely for the world's own good. But what she discovers in Gopher Prairie is a cultural desert, devoid of anything but the mundane and mediocre. The social life of the town revolves about an elite little group of young matrons called the Jolly 17. This tight little circle devotes its efforts toward holding monthly dinners, bridge parties, and socials. Carol finds little intellectual stimulation and decides to contribute the fruits of her liberal education to the Thanatopsis Study Club, the Women's Literary Society. Here, Carol naively thinks she will find a genuine and deep interest in the arts and letters. But she is soon to be disappointed. At her first meeting, Carol finds, to her dismay, that the lives of all the English poets, from Shakespeare through Byron, Scott, Moore, and Burns, were recounted in superficial detail. When Carol hesitatingly suggests that it might be nice to spend an entire meeting on the study of some of the poetry, perhaps even read some of it aloud and look at its meaning, its rhyme scheme, and so forth, the group somewhat reluctantly agrees to schedule such a day sometime in the distant and ambiguous future. Carol sighs and flees for home. But Lewis treads on more serious ground in the novel, and what was commonly voiced along main streets everywhere became shocking when seen in stark black print. Carol, who admired the pioneering spirit, goes to visit the Champ Perrys, one of the original founding families of Gopher Prairie, and during the course of the afternoon, draws from the Perrys the principles by which Gopher Prairie should be born again, should again become an amusing place to live in. Some of the philosophical gems gleaned from these rugged pioneers were these.
The Baptist Church, in somewhat less the Methodist, Congregational, and Presbyterian churches, is the perfect, divinely ordained standard in music, oratory, philanthropy, and ethics.
We don't need all of this newfangled science or this terrible higher criticism that's ruining our young men in college.
We need to get back to the true word of God and a good sound belief in hell, like we used to have it preached to us.
The Republican Party of Blaine and McKinley is the agent of the Lord and of the Baptist Church in temporal affairs.
Harold Bell Wright is a lovely writer. He teaches such good morals in novels, and folks say he's made pretty near $1 million out of them.
Well, people who make more than $10,000 a year or less than $800 are wicked.
Europeans are wickeder. It doesn't hurt anyone to drink a glass of beer on a warm day. But anyone who touches wine is headed straight to hell. Virgins are not as virginal as they used to be.
Farmers want too much for their wheat. And the owners of the elevator company expect too much work for the salaries they pay.
There'd be no more trouble or discontent in this world if everyone worked as hard as Pa did when he cleared our first farm.
Thus spoke the Champ Perrys, and Carol's hero worship withers and dies. And she goes home once again with a headache to ponder the inscrutability of fate. And if the guiding philosophies and principles of the pioneering founders of Gopher Prairie are found to be somewhat lacking in substance, well, the point was not lost on many readers. The immediate reactions to the book fell into two categories: outright laughter on the part of the readers, or downright untempered naked fury. As the novel moves onward, Lewis continues to jab away at sacrosanct American ideals. For instance, he points out that in Gopher Prairie, it's not good form to be holy except in church between 10:30 and 12 on Sunday. And American freedom takes on a new meaning as Jack Elder, a local entrepreneur, defined it. I stand for freedom and constitutional right. If a man don't like my shop, he can get up and get. Same way, if I don't like him, he gets. And that's all there is to it. They like what I pay them or they get out. So the young woman with a working mind and no work to do struggles valiantly against the rigid conformity of the community and somehow is only slightly infected by the village virus, a strange disease that saps the will and strength of newcomers and causes them to sink to the apathetic level of the rest of the town. Even at the end of the book, Carol admits she has not fought the good fight, but vows she will continue the struggle.
I haven't even started. Look, do you see that object on the pillow? Do you know what it is? It's a bomb to blow up smugness. If you toys were wise, you wouldn't arrest anarchists. You'd arrest these children while they're still asleep in their cribs. Just think what that baby will see and meddle with before she dies in the year 2000. She may see an industrial union of the whole world. She may see aeroplanes going to Mars. Oh, I'll go on always. But I have won in this. I've never excused my failures by sneering at my aspirations, by pretending to have gone beyond them. I do not admit that Main Street is as beautiful as it should be. I do not admit that Gopher Prairie is more generous or greater than Europe. I do not admit that dishwashing is enough to satisfy all women. I may not have fought the good fight, but I have kept the faith.
Her husband nods patiently and then remarks that he'd better hurry and get the storm windows in, for it looks as if it will snow soon. And thus the novel ends. Critical reception to the novel was splendid. It was Lewis's most successful book. He had found his niche as a writer of satire, a slashing, vitriolic kind of satire. The reviews were overwhelmingly favorable, although one Episcopal bishop publicly wrapped the book and declared it pagan. Lewis had become at once a debunker in an era when debunking was highly popular, and a social reformer in an era when social reform was desperately needed. Lewis had quickly realized that provincialism, pomposity, and chauvinism had stamped their marks on people and prevented them from realizing a higher potential. And he hoped that his novel would cause reaction. One critic said that Lewis attempted to minister to the nation's ills by injecting carbolic acid into the national funny bone. Well, reaction he got. And strangely enough, the public flocked to the booksellers to get hold of this pagan book that aroused so much ire. The novel became not only a critical success, but a commercial success as well. In the view of one critic, it was the publishing event of the century up until that time, and the presses could barely keep up with the demand. But the dust had hardly settled when 2 years later, Lewis's next novel, Babbitt, again called to task one of the country's most sacred and revered institutions, the free enterprise system, and the American middle-class businessman who made it all work so efficiently. Some of the territory had been briefly explored in Main Street, but in Babbitt, Lewis zeroed in on the details with a vengeance, and Babbitt became an even greater indictment of America's middle class. And once again, the readers were either amused or outraged. While Carol Kennicott was a romantic idealist, George Follansbee Babbitt was a rock-ribbed, practical, and conventionally honest businessman who was adept at selling houses for more than they were worth. Within a short time after its publication, the novel was to add a new word, Babbitt, to our language. This word soon came to epitomize the self-satisfied individual who readily conforms to conventional middle-class ideas and ideals, especially those ideas of achieving business success in the most expeditious way and accumulating and amassing material possessions. George F. Babbitt, became the symbol of the conniving, grasping businessman so often admired by those wanting to achieve the American dream. That their ethics might be questioned and that their business practices, well, might be a trifle shady, were often overlooked or ignored or forgiven with the glib excuse that it was merely being sharp, being smart, being on the ball. And besides, it was business, wasn't it? He is an unabashed social climber and will promote any cause that in turn will boost his own status and fortune. Yet, for all his shortcomings and failings, one can feel empathy for this little standardized man. Babbitt, in essence, is merely a victim, as well we all might be, of forces we neither understand nor control. And while Lewis was roundly accused of creating a one-sided caricature in Babbitt, there are moments of self-doubt that come to this little man, doubts that nag at him, until he flirts with actual rebellion against his class and his kind. For a time, he even succumbs to the pressures of the new morality that was sweeping across the 1920s as America shed the trappings of the Victorians and introduced bobbed hair, short skirts, and jazz. Babbitt drinks bootleg gin, frequents speakeasies, runs with a fast crowd, and toys at the edge of an affair. But in spite of his fling, he worries a bit about personal salvation and his ascendancy into heaven, which he pictures as something like a fine hotel with beautiful gardens. And so returns to the fold, the lost sheep who has found his way. He plunges headlong into the activities of the world he knows so well, the world of offices, cars, sales, and money. Babbitt is a man of strong convictions and opinions, most of which he got from Zenith's daily newspaper, the Advocate Times. If these opinions seem exaggerated, remember that exaggeration is part of the satirist's stock and trade. Remember, too, that Babbitt's views were generally accepted by many Americans at the time. Babbitt, like a number of us today, worries a good deal about government and world conditions and their effects on prosperity. And he takes very seriously anything that poses a threat to the country.
The worst menace to sound government is not the avowed socialist, but a lot of cowards who work undercover. The long-haired gentry who call themselves liberals and radicals and nonpartisan and intelligentsia and God only knows how many other trick names. The first thing you've got to understand is that all this uplift and flip-flop and settlement work and recreation is nothing in God's world but the entering wedge for socialism. The sooner a man learns he isn't going to be coddled and he needn't expect a lot of free grub and all these free classes and flip-flop and doodads for his kids unless he earns them, why, the sooner he'll get on the job and produce, produce, produce. That's what the country needs, and not all this fancy stuff that just enfeebles the willpower of the working man and gives his kids a lot of notions above their class.
Babbitt held conventional ideas about the role of organized labor in American society. He saw labor unions as useful if they could be controlled by the employer. Otherwise,
George,
they should be eliminated.
You see what the traction union people are up to again?
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, a good union is of value because it keeps out the radical unions, which would destroy property. No one should be forced to join a union, however. All labor agitators who try to force men to join a union should be hanged. In fact, just between ourselves, there oughtn't to be any unions allowed at all. And as it's the best way of fighting unions, every businessman ought to belong to an employers' association and to the Chamber of Commerce. In union, there is strength. So any selfish hog who doesn't join the Chamber of Commerce ought to be forced to.
If there's a slight tinge of irony to that pronouncement, so be it. As I said, Babbitt has many opinions, and not all of them are devoted solely to business and economics. He strongly supports education.
And roll down.
But he does question some aspects of the general curriculum.
Yeah. I'll tell you why you've got to study Shakespeare in those. It's because they're required for college entrance, and that's all there is to it. It'd be a great deal better if you took business English and learned how to write an ad or letters that pull. Well, there it is. There's no talk, argument, or discussion about it. You know, I found out that it's a fine thing to be able to say that you're a B.A. Some client who doesn't know what you are or thinks you're just a plug businessman gets to shooting off his mouth about economics or literature or foreign trade conditions, and you just ease in something like, oh, when I was in college, of course, I got my B.A. in sociology and all that junk. It puts an awful crimp in their style. Of course, I'd never admit it publicly. Well, like myself, a State U graduate. Well, it's only decent and patriotic for him to blow his own horn. But it's a matter of fact. There's a whole lot of valuable time lost, even at the U, studying poetry and French and subjects that never brought in anybody a penny. I don't know, but maybe these correspondence courses might prove to be one of the most important American inventions.
There we have education as it should be. According to Babbitt, education ought to be practical so that it will help contribute to the size of a man's bank account. Nor does Babbitt ignore the cultural side of American life. No, no, he does not neglect art and music and literature. And he knows in his heart that his instincts for the finer things of life are right.
In other countries, art and literature are left to a lot of shabby bums living in attics and feeding on booze and spaghetti. But in America, the successful writer or picture painter is indistinguishable from any other decent businessman. And I, for one, am only too glad that a man who has the rare skill of seasoning his message with interesting reading matter and shows both purpose and pep in handling his literary wares has a chance to drag down his $50,000 a year, to mingle with the biggest executives on terms of perfect equality, and to show as big a house and as fine a car as any captain of industry. In no other country in the world will you find so many reproductions of the old masters and of well-known paintings hanging on parlor walls as in these United States. No country has anything like our number of phonographs. Well, not only dance records, but also the best operas, such as Verdi, performed by the highest paid singers in the world.
With this shocking portrayal of Babbitt, Lewis added new meaning to the word Philistine. The Babbitts of the world, as Lewis observed, thrive in the culture of gaudy commercialism. And Lewis saw, too, that American life was becoming too garish, too brassy, and his exposure of it disturbed the public. Yet Babbitt, for all his uplift and hustling and glad-handing, is really a pathetic character who has, in the words of one critic, a faint sense that the values of excellence, joy, passion, wisdom do indeed exist somewhere. But sadly, Babbitt does not know how to find them. Babbitt, in the words of another reviewer, is the story of a little man who is trapped by the worship of success and by the materialism of the world about him, and who in the end becomes a victim of his shallow illusions. What followed over the next few years were four savage, slashing satirical novels that kept the reading public stirred up and enhanced Lewis's reputation not only as a writer, but as a biting social critic. Lewis, it was obvious, was not afraid to attack so-called sacred American ideals and institutions. Religion had come under his critical eye in all his satiric novels. From brief, biting references in Main Street, Lewis further ridiculed the idea of piety and profit in Babbitt. Mike Monday, A former boxer turned evangelist who claims to have converted 100,000 lost souls at an average cost of $10 a soul typifies Lewis's attitude toward the evangelistic pursuits of religion. His account of a Sunday school membership drive is a hilarious study of a religion that is measured by numbers of dollars, while the true precepts of faith are lost somewhere among the rubbish of modern advertising and commercial sales techniques. Well, all this bitterness culminates in the novel Elmer Gantry, published in 1927. Lewis paints the ugly portrait of a hypocritical saver of souls, using painstaking detail in chronicling the rise of this self-indulgent sensualist from a drunken, rowdy divinity student to the hierarchy of the established church. Along the way, Elmer Gantry sharpens and hones his oratorical abilities in the hard but oh-so-profitable business of evangelism. Perhaps the following quotation suggests the kind of religion Lewis railed against. Here, Elmer Gantry is discussing a new strategy for attacking sin and corruption by direct and specific reference, by name, if you will, with an experienced staff member, Dr. Binch, who hastens to point out the inherent flaws of such a strategy.
There's danger in that sort of thing, though. Trouble is, in such an attack, you're liable to offend some of the leading church members, the very folks that contribute the most cash to a revival. They're often the owners of buildings that get used by unscrupulous persons for immoral purposes. And while they, of course, regret such unfortunate use of their property, if you attack such places by name, you're likely to lose their support. Why, you might lose thousands of dollars. It seems to me wiser and more Christian to just attack vice in general.
Lewis was riding the crest of his literary achievements during the golden years of the 1920s, winning the Pulitzer Prize in 1926 for Aerosmith. He declined it because he said he felt that no board of judges was capable of determining the best novel of the year. Of course, his actions stunned the literary world. And as with most everything Lewis wrote, the critics and the public were divided in their reactions. Thus, he maintained his reputation as being America's most unpredictable and irascible writer. His popularity brought money and fame, but he seemed to have difficulty handling both. He began to drink heavily, although to his credit, he drank nothing stronger than iced coffee or beer when he was in the middle of a novel. Once the work was complete, however, the drinking commenced again. For a while, he was much sought after for social gatherings, but his unpredictable nature made him something of a social bore. Cicely Huddleston, a fellow writer, remembered him as tall, angular, jerky in manner, subject to moody silence, then breaking into interminable talk. At parties, he would either sit glumly in a corner or would dominate the scene with a verbose stream of words. Soon, people began to cross him off their lists. Yet, from a career standpoint, the decade after 1920 was his most productive. He crowned his literary achievement in 1930 by becoming America's first Nobel Prize-winning author, an honor and an award he did not refuse. In a statement to the press, he gave his reasons for accepting the Nobel Prize. "The Nobel Prize is an international prize with no strings tied. It is awarded on the basis of excellence of work, on the basis of an author's entire work up to the time of the award." On December 12, 1930, a tuxedoed Sinclair Lewis mounted the podium in Stockholm to address the Swedish Academy and to accept his prize. He became the first American so honored. Ironically, he was at the pinnacle of his creative powers when he went to Stockholm, and almost from that point on, he began a slow decline. Although he wrote steadily for the next 21 years, his work never seemed to achieve either the quality or the power of what he wrote between 1920 and 1930, and the critics and the public began to abandon him. However, this is not to say that he did not produce works of worth. For example, his novel, It Can't Happen Here, is a chilling account of what could take place in America if a fascist government took over. And King's Blood Royal was one of the early novels to face squarely the race issues. In all, he wrote 23 novels, several plays, hundreds of short stories, and dozens of poems, essays, and film scripts. His personal life was unhappy. He married twice. First, Grace Livingston Hegar, then the well-known political columnist Dorothy Thompson. Both marriages ended in divorce. He lost a son in World War II, and he was aware of his own failing powers as a writer. Yet he was still feared as a satirist. Time magazine reported a story about his brief career as a university instructor. It seems that he joined the English faculty of the University of Wisconsin to teach a creative writing course. While there, he noticed a certain aloofness on the part of the faculty, a certain reserved coolness in his relationship with his teaching colleagues. Later, he learned that the faculty feared that he had come among them to gather material for another satire. He was always a restless man, and he never seemed to establish a permanent home. At various times, he lived in Vermont, New York, St. Louis, St. Paul, Chicago, Duluth. And as he grew older, he began to stay in Europe for longer and longer periods of time. He alienated himself from friends and associates. His drinking was a serious problem now, and on more than one occasion, he suffered the awful horrors of delirium tremens. Lewis went to Italy to get the warm Mediterranean sun. His health failed, and he was stricken by a heart attack on January 9th, 1951. He died the next day, alone among strangers. After a brief, simple ceremony, his ashes were interred at Sauk Center's Greenwood Cemetery next to his parents. Lewis's love-hate relationship with this small Minnesota town had come full circle. America's smasher of sacred images and overthrower of established institutions had passed from the scene. That he was controversial, no one will dispute. That he made solid contributions to American literature, no one will deny. Perhaps Louis Untermeyer sums up his place in American literature as well as anyone has. First and last, Louis is one of the century's sharpest delineators of manners. Uniquely combining shrewd wit and broad humor, he endowed absurd and even repulsive figures with compelling plausibility. His novels are essentially a gallery of portraits as native and representative of his country as Pickwick, Don Quixote, Siegfried, Raskolnikov, and Cyrano are of theirs. They are the kind of books Dickens might have written, had Dickens acquired an impressionistic point of view, a 20th century staccato style, and a ringing American accent. Thank you.
Funding for this program was provided through a grant from the Ohio Humanities Council, a state-based program of the National Endowment for the Humanities.